morning, one and all. I am Dr. Srishti Bagde, a resident from MGM Hospital, and I would like to welcome each and every one present here. We've gathered here for an interactive session on various topics related to cornea refractive surgery and keratoplasty. I hope we all have a wonderful session, and I know for sure that us residents are going to benefit greatly from this session and the various talks that are going to happen. I would like to call Dr. Suvarna Kalapat for a case presentation.
I will be presenting this case. We have 20-year-old female presented with halos all through the cornea in right eye and difficulty in driving. Patient was operated 1 year back and LASIK was performed, and his complaint began at post-op day 1.
So you know what? Now how we have done this was that we have collective experience of LASIK. I think more than 40 years collective. The big man has been doing for 20 years.
No, more than.
Maybe more than
1991. 31, 30 years.
Siddharth has been doing it for 15 years. You've been doing it for so many years. Sanjeev has not reached anything.
Sanjeev also.
So many years. So if you get a patient like this, what we will do is one by one, take the money. How will you work? Maybe Siddharth can start.
I was lost in my presentation.
Okay, sorry. So if you see a case like this, a patient who is complaining of halos and difficulty in driving in one eye after LASIK, started post-op day one, how would you work up a case like this?
See, my first thing, I'll do a thorough complete examination. What is there any refractive residual error? And scotopic pupil size, that is the one thing I'll look, because she told me halos in the night time.
All over the day.
So we have to see, even if a small refractive error sometime or small cell residual can cause a lot of halos and glare. See the proper positioning of the flap, whether it is there or not. If it is eccentric, can cause that problem. The central area of the pupil is clear or not. And then definitely scotopic, and pupil size is the most important aspect in this.
First thing, okay, as Dr. Kapoor has said, the first thing you look at is at the pupil size. What is missing over here is a preoperative refractive error, which is very, very, very important.
That's there. So if you can give it to him.
Yeah, okay. So not very low, not very high. So minus 7.25 would cause quite a lot of positive shift in the queue. So we need to know what platform was it was operated on. And
I'm so sorry.
Anyway, so it depends on as to what profile was used. Okay, if it was an aspheric profile, probably the optical zone size was a little small. So the next thing and the most important thing to do is a topography. Look at the optical zone sizes. If they have shrunk, now they're not that bad. They seem okay. So now what do you do in this patient? Is there any residual error? It's in the positive side. You don't want to touch this patient.
That's what.
Give, start him on alpha, can pray for, pray to the God that something happens. Yeah, sure, you can give a washout, maybe you can give a topo-guided treatment, but usually these things don't work. What this patient requires is more of reassurance rather than anything else. Okay, this is what I tell my patients. If you try to find God, you'll surely find God. If you're going to try to look for halos, they will see halos. I give the example of people getting hiccups. You keep on thinking that you have hiccups, they don't stop. The minute you're distracted, they go. So now what do you do for this patient? A lot and lot of reassurance, and probably start them on alpha-gam.
Alpha-gam, why?
Okay, now you can start them on pilocarpine or alpha-gam. You would not start them on pilocarpine on this patient, especially not without seeing the retina is already positive. So maybe pilocarpine, if you are going to dilute it, maybe like 1:8, 1:10. Now pilocarpine would surely constrict the pupil. Night vision could be better, but there will always be some amount of myopic shift. So more positive, we don't want that. Alpha-gam will, theoretically, doesn't work in all my patients. If I give it to around 4 patients, maybe one of them would be happy. So it decreases the dilatation of the pupil when the patient responds to light. And the very simple thing to do is, the patient's driving the car, tell him put the light of the car on, so the pupil is already constricted. So, you know, this happens when they go driving in a lane where it's very dark and all of a sudden the pupil expands or something. So tell them to put the headlight, the light, internal light on, seems to work in most cases. But surgically?
See, spherical equivalent is a little minus, but...
It's okay, but I really don't think touching would help. Because
can you go back? Can you go back to the topo? I mean, could you analyze that little, you know, that area which is flatter than the rest of it?
Very frank, post op topos.
Yeah.
Don't read too much into it.
No.
Don't read. Do not touch this patient. He will be unhappy. An unhappy patient is always an unhappy patient, respect of whatever you do.
Touching would be very dicing. This I won't touch this.
No.
No. I won't touch. Reassure.
Well, Dr. Sonali has been doing that for the last 1 year, but she's not leaving her clinic.
Best is give a number. Best is to give a half number. I've done that.
Arish, Sashi,
what do you
think? I think. Suresh, we need chairs.
Rajneesh, chairs.
What were you thinking? Sorry, Sonali, could you
Sonali wants a mic.
I was saying that I have used pilocarpine, diluted pilocarpine. I have used Alphagan also, reassurance. I mean, lots and lots of it for a year. But and also, I have given her that cylinder, 0.75, but it's just not working.
So, what were you thinking?
Do a TCAT.
TCAT. So what?
Take the mic. No?
Yeah, smoothening means what, according to you, is not smooth or what is regular you're finding. From what I and what he just said, Siddharth just said, all topos look like this. You will not find a post-op topo.
You hear this one?
No, yeah, thanks. You will not, if you do enough post-op topos, you will find that you don't get topos which are smooth, uniform, regular, okay? So there's nothing special about this patch here or this bend here or this bend here. You can't smoothen this. So I don't think there's any role of this TCAT. There's nothing irregular, you know. So she's almost zero, plus 0.25. My half the world is 0.25.
She's spherical equivalent minus 0.12. That's it.
Plus 0.25 minus 0.25 cylinder zero. Spherical equivalent is 0.
Plus and 0.5 minus 0.7.
Change the slide. One eye.
So,
this is spherical equivalent is minus 0.25.
Plus.
Yeah, minus, if you transpose this.
Plus spherical equivalent is plus point something, very small.
Plus 0. Something.
Yeah, very small.
0.2, what can you do with it? You cannot treat 0.2s and 0.this. Okay. So that is out of the question. Now, to summarize everything. There is no known cause of halos. There are theories about halos. That the pupil, you can talk in a Western country where they have 7 millimeter pupils. This is tropical country. Everybody is 2.5 millimeter whole day. She's saying whole day. He never said night. In this sunlight, what pupil? She's got a 2.5 millimeter pupil. So these are theories. Post LASIK, they get halos. Okay, Khara.
I'll quote a video of ACR. Go to ACR's website. Just a recent video has been uploaded about halos and glare. They are trying to quantify halos and glare. They are not able to. And we are trying to quantify halos. Why are they there? They are not able to. There is no theory explained. Even in monofocal IOLs, where there should be no halos, they are supposed to be 40% patient complaining of halos. So these are mainly neurological symptoms you may not be able to treat. And touching and fingering the patient may get it. So be very careful in touching these patients. So I would say refer to some of the
treatments. So have those 16 people come?
Yeah.
So everyone's come?
Even though sir does not need any introduction, but for the uninitiated, let me give a brief introduction. Dr. Shashi Kapoor has pioneered excimer laser refractive surgery for myopia in India since 1991, and at present is an honorary professor in JJ Hospital and Grant Medical College, Mumbai. He performs more than 2,000 eczema laser procedures a year. I would like to invite sir to give us a talk on corneal topography.
Good morning, everyone. My apologies to Tushar and Ashok Bole, who for the third time have to listen to topography. But we were at the same time in JJ, fourth time. But we were at the same time in JJ, you know, a little bit 1 year ahead and behind. So anything is allowed. Now, I took a liberty of adding a few slides because it was mainly PGs. So little, you know, going into little detail. And I am not a corneal surgeon. I have done corneal fellowship, but I don't practice corneal surgery. I'm a refractive surgeon. Refractive surgery happens to be done on the cornea. So my whole orientation is towards topography as far as refractive surgery is concerned. I'm not concerned with corneal diseases and that in this presentation. So topography today is commonly, good morning. Morning, welcome. Is commonly today called pentacam, okay? So pentacam is like the word Xerox, okay? Which is a photocopying machine, but it's called Xerox. So this is an elevation topography, okay? Which is the present fashion. That you want to know the shape of the cornea, you take it by measuring the height. And this is today common and in vogue. Originally or traditionally, it was placebo disc based. The argument which is better can go on and on and on and on. But as of now, in the last few years, even the companies, what they did is combine both. Today, a modern is not pentacam, it is Cirrus, it is Galilee, which gives you both elevation, that was pentacam, and a Placido. Nobody gives you both because nobody wants to lose the order, okay? There are people who say Placido still is better. So cornea is aspherotorical, like a bell with little flattened sides and a slight width the rule, astigmatism half to one diopter, vertically steep, and the only 6-7 millimeter is ellipsoidal centrally and a constant curvature. Otherwise, it is not. Why is this all important? That all the optics that we study assumes a sphere. But the cornea has nothing to do with a sphere. All this, if you take, there's nothing spherical about it. Okay. So, in the placebo disc, you can get fine Meyers, you can get thick Meyers, you can get colored Meyers. So, you can get a cone shaped target, you can get a large like this type of, you know, placebo disc. There are differences between the two. The large ones cover less area. The cone ones cover more area. Okay, so you can see smaller area being covered, larger area being covered. And these give you maps. Okay. Now, a map, these are computers. You give them data, they can make 100 things with it. So different type of maps will give you different. Some map will give you more idea about a shape, and some will give you more idea about the optics of the cornea. So all the maps have different names. If you take a height map, you're talking more of shape. You take a curvature map, you're talking about shape. As you go into these type of maps, you're talking about the visual or optical quality of the cornea. So the axial map, the refractive map, the wavefront map. So the commonest map is an axial map, okay? The axial map forces any point of the cornea to be measured from the optical axis. Okay, so this is supposed to be less of shape, more of optics. The second most important map is a curvature map. Different machines will call it instantaneous map, this map, tangential map. It means that along any meridian, every zone has a center of curvature that is not on the optical axis. So this point is being measured from here. This point is being measured from here, not from this. So this is truer representation of what you see on slit lamp. If you see a big steep area, axial map, it's written there. You don't have to study how to know. is written here, instantaneous. You see, this is more localized, like what you might see on the slit lamp. Okay. If you see this, this is axial map. This is a instantaneous map, tangential, some companies will call it. You can see more details, more this. This is a post-LASIK, you can see the central flattening. So, now, in the fight which took place 5-7 years back, when Pentachem was launched, Pentachem didn't have the Placido because they were introducing, saying that Placido is useless. Okay, so how did they prove Placido is useless? That the curvature-based system, which are Placido, so they assume that visual axis, corneal apex, we know they are not in a straight line. Okay, and the VK normal means the normal of the machine itself. Okay. Sorry. So they assume that the corneal apex, the visual axis, and the axis of the machine are in one line. It's not. Okay. So they said that you need a new technology to overcome this. Okay. And therefore they said that you should have this type of elevation technology. Another difference was Placido always misses out some area which is interpolated. Extrapolated rather, and this usually covers a little larger area. Okay, so elevation topology was actually much older than Pentachem. Pentachem did a lot of noise. Orbscan, which was made by Bosch and Lomb, is very, very old. There are more than hundreds of installations in India, even in India. It had a scanning slit technology. All that Pentachem did was the same height and measurement with a Scheimpflug camera. Okay, both these systems create optical cross sections of the cornea, and that gives you anterior posterior view and pachymetry, because if you have anterior posterior, you know the depth. In Placido, you get only anterior, so you can't get depth. In refractive surgery, pachymetry is so important. Okay, but it was nothing new. Orbscan gives the same thing. Completely same thing. Okay. So what is Scheimpflug? What was the Pentachem principle? Was simply in a camera, you've got a lens, you've got a film, you've got an object. They're always parallel. If you make them meet at a point, it gives depth in the picture. If you get depth, you get pachymetry. So it gives you pachymetry, it gives you elevation maps naturally, and even anterior segment evaluation, anterior chamber angle, depth, volume, and even up to the lens, anterior posterior surface of the lens, densitometry. Actually, elevation topology, you cannot read at all. This is elevation data of a normal patient, mild keratoconus, advanced keratoconus. You cannot interpret elevation topology. Everything looks same. Okay? So, the raw data is impossible to interpret. Why is it impossible? It is like this is the Earth, 12,000 kilometers is the size. Mount Everest is only 8 kilometers. How come you can see Mount Everest is so big? Because you're standing at sea level. You're just standing 8 kilometers away. Suppose you go to the center of the earth, 6,000 kilometers. Will you be able to know that something is there, mountain? You won't know. So you had to create a sea level. Same way in elevation topology, it is same. Cornea is 12,000 microns. If you have a 6 micron bump, it's impossible to see. Unless you create a sea level. If you create a sea level, from there it's 6 microns. Okay. So that artificial creation is what is known as a close fitting reference surface. The green is closely fitting the cornea, and it is called a best fit sphere, because normally we use sphere. Modern machines can give you 100 options to use toric shape, ellipsoid shape, toric ellipsoid, asymmetric. So, but traditionally it's a sphere, and therefore it is called BFS, best fit sphere. Okay. Once you have got the sphere can have different shape, like we said, it could be ellipsoidal, it could be whatever. It can have different size and different alignment. If you change the size and alignment, the picture changes. Okay. So, now you interpret elevation topology. This is your yellow cornea. You create a green surface. Whatever is above the surface, you can make it red. Whatever is below is blue. You see that the flatter part actually falls below the reference surface and is blue. The steeper part goes above. So normal prolate corneas, the apex usually goes above, you get a red center, and the flatter periphery falls below the reference surface, BFS. And therefore you get this type of picture. It's called central hill and an annular C. Okay. And a normal astigmatic cornea is toric. Toric means it has a steeper meridian and a flatter meridian. The steeper meridian usually falls below the reference surface. See, that's why the steeper meridian has become blue, not red. In Placido, it's opposite. And the flatter meridian, in fact, goes above the reference surface, and that one becomes red, opposite of Placido. Okay? So you'll find that this is a normal toric cornea. It's called a central saddle. You see, they look opposite. Here, the steep red color is actually blue. Here, the steep is the yellow, orange, red. Okay? So this reference sphere can have different alignments. Okay? The alignment depends on the center of that sphere. If the center of the sphere is on the viewing axis, it is called center aligned. If the center of the sphere is anywhere but the reference sphere intersects the cornea on the viewing axis, it is called pinned alignment. Normally is floating alignment. Floating means you don't give any instruction to the sphere. It is just as close a fit as possible. This is the default alignment in most machines. But because they are computerized, they give you all options, you can keep playing around, everything will change. If you change it, everything changes. So this is the same patient with floating alignment, axial alignment, apex alignment, pin. You can't make out anything. So don't change anything. Go with the default settings, okay, which is normally, see, this is a sphere, okay, best fit sphere. If you change the shape, like we said, you can change from sphere to toric ellipsoid. Toric ellipsoid fits very closely a normal cornea because normal cornea is toric. So now there is no difference to see. It looks just normal, normal, normal here. This much difference is there because if you put a sphere, you are allowing the differences to come out. Okay. So that is why normally we stick to a sphere. It's called BFS, best fit sphere. It usually has a fit zone. It's usually, for example, pentacam. It is usually default is BFS sphere, diameter, fit zone, about 8 millimeters, and the alignment is float. Normal alignment, no special instructions to the sphere. Okay. How do you know normal, abnormal? You should know what normal looks like. Normal elevation maps look like this. Island, ridge. This is called a ridge. Regular ridge, irregular ridge, incomplete ridge, complete ridge, and what does it? Now, why are they color-coded? You are not supposed to study the map. It is color. You should see red, it is steep. You see blue, it is flat. So color-coding forms an integral part of the map. It is not just a routine matter. Okay. So central corneal power is approximately Gaussian distribution. The mean is 43.5, which is given green color. 66% one standard deviation, 42 to 45. This is represented by adjacent of the green, adjacent light yellow, light blue. Okay. Less than 3% of population are outside three standard deviation. So those colors are given red and dark blue. If you see red and dark blue, it is highly likely that they're abnormal. Okay, this is the value of the color. Once you talk about color, you have to talk about scale. What is scale? Absolute scale is used for screening. Don't change it. There are only two scales, absolute and normalized. So in this, blue is always flat, green is always middle, orange is always steep. Okay, so you look at this map, you know, array, flat cornea, blues. This is steeper than this. You know, to zoom in and study more details, there's a normalized map. Normalized means you take the patient's cornea, if it is 48, and make it green. You take the patient's cornea 40 and make it green. So both maps look same. Okay, both look same. This has its uses, but if you use it normally, you get confused. You can't make out this is 48, this is 39 cornea, this is 48 cornea. Both look same. Whereas this is a color-coded system meant to help us look and identify. Okay. Now this fellow, 38 and 42, it's correct, absolute scale. It's correct, it looks flatter. But you put him in a normalized scale, it looks red, it looks abnormal. Like what would look in a you know, 40 to 53 in an absolute scale. So for screening, we must use an absolute scale. The difference between the steps of the colors, the same patient now, see this difference in the step of the color is one diopter, from one color to next, one color. Here the same thing, you have made it half diopter, same thing you have made it quarter diopter, look how it looks abnormal. So when you make two smaller interval, the normal things will get magnified to look abnormal. And if you have two bigger step interval, you might miss small abnormalities. So you have to be somewhere in between. So now we are discussing only the placebo max. Okay. We are not discussing elevation. So when you see the map, what are the normal? So this was classified as, you can classify round, see the hottest color on the map. So round, about 20% of the population, oval, about 20% of the population. This sort of bow tie, or you know, bow tie, which is with the rule astigmatism, when it's vertical, against the rule astigmatism, oblique astigmatism, and what do you call that? Hourglass, no? Hourglass shape. So central astigmatism limited to the center and extending to the periphery, limbus to limbus. This, if you're talking, today's meeting is for LASIK, for refractive surgery. There's only one slide which is important out of all the slides. This slide. The only one slide. Asymmetric astigmatism, where one lobe is different from the other lobe. Finished. Okay? We are discussing LASIK and topography. Topography machines are not purchased by corneal surgeons. They are purchased by LASIK surgeons. It is comes free with the LASIK machine. Not free, they charge you, but they compulsorily put it. Okay. So because you are not supposed to do LASIK in only one type of patient, keratoconus. And this is the picture of keratoconus. The whole machine has been bought so that you can refuse the money of a patient whose topography looks like this. Okay, other there's no interest in topography of a refractive surgeon. Okay, if he sees this picture, he's supposed to send the patient back. So what are the normal shapes? Round, oval, and bow tie, symmetric bow tie, asymmetric bow tie, and irregular. Okay, these are the ones which are abnormal for refractive surgery. Okay, and usually it's assumed that these are normal round to, this is a normal progression. Okay, the different shapes of the cornea. The two eyes usually show very high symmetry, mirror image symmetry, called enantiomorphism. Now, God decided to make things interesting. He already knew that by the time 2010, you know, there's going to, these humans are going to discover LASIK machines, and they will have to take this camera and take picture of the cornea. And keratoconus to be refused. So he made one third of whole Nerul have the same asymmetric bow tie as a normal. If Nerul has 10 lakh people, 3 lakh people normally have an asymmetric bow tie. And they're all walking into Shivam or to Rajesh's clinic and saying, I want LASIK. He's taking the photo and it shows this. Now take the patient or don't take the patient. So the whole issue is to differentiate, good morning madam, the whole issue is to differentiate a normal asymmetric bow tie from, which is impossible, from, I am telling you now, so if you want to go to sleep, you need not listen to the next remaining. They are identical maps. Okay. So, what is keratoconus? That is not my, I told you I'm not a cornea surgeon, and we have got very good corneal surgeons who will tell us so much about keratoconus. I am interested in the refractive surgeon's angle, whom to refuse. Okay? So I study only that part. That its prevalence varies from 2 in 1 lakh to 40 in 1 lakh, depending on the race, the part of the world you're living in. I am taking average 30. 2 ke badle no, 60 also no, 30. 30 in 1 lakh, okay, means 300 patients in 10 lakh, suppose Nerul has 10 lakh people. 300 will have keratoconus. Chalo, theek hai. But 3 lakh people will have normal asymmetric bow tie, 1/3. So for 300, 3 lakh. So for 1,000 asymmetric bow ties, only one is abnormal. So you will see 1,000 identical topos and you have to refuse 999. And you have to separate them. How can you separate? How can you say that one of the identical 1,000 topos is abnormal? It is looking for a needle in a haystack. You know, it is impossible. But good morning, Sanjeev sir. Please come here. We have kept this first bench, sir. Sanjeev sir is one of the oldest LASIK surgeons in Mumbai. It must be Maharashtra. From Ulas. Welcome, sir.
Extra.
So this is the scope of the problem. So we are going, just reviewing, I'm just one slide, my point. Dr. Sonali will talk what is keratoconus. That ultimately what is written in Parson, what is keratoconus, this, second, third, that ultimately we have to go back to that. Scissoring reflex, there are no retinoscopes left, but even then Tushar has one, he has used it 18 years. And then they'll say that you look if there's keratoconus. First of all, there's no keratoconus. Patient had myopia, she came to know Dr. Ramchandran, he said he's got a machine which can remove myopia. She doesn't have keratoconus. She has just come, but your topos is asymmetrical, astigmatism. So these things in real keratoconus, if your slit lamp is better than upper swami and all, you'll be able to see nerves and this thinning and all this scarring. Okay, this flesher's ring, impossible. But even then, you might see. Chalo. So this is keratoconus, but there is no keratoconus. It is just that the patient walked into your clinic and has asymmetric bow tie, which is there in 1/3 of the population. 3 lakh people in Nerul have asymmetric bow tie. Okay. Now this was thing. Now a little bit what is going to be covered by Dr. Tushar Cheda after this. And after we finish LASIK, we are talking about cataract. So the asphericity. But little it include, it's included in LASIK, so I have to include 2-3 slides. So corneal profile in any meridian is considered a conic section. Conic. What is conic section? Conic section is formed by intersection of a plane and a right circular cone. So the kind of curve produced depends on the angle at which you intersect this cone. This cone, you're intersecting it with a plane. The shape produced will depend on the angle. If you go like this, you'll get a circle. If you go like this, you get an ellipse. If you go like this, you get parabola, as the angle is steepening. Okay. Why is this angle? This is important. People in big conferences, you hear Q values, Q, Q, Q. So I went into the depth. I'm from JJ keyboard, Q, well, A, B, C, we start from there. So this is the conic section. Okay, cornea. So conic section has two parameters. Apical radius and the radius of the remaining part. Okay. So apical radius and eccentricity. Eccentricity is departure of the peripheral curvature from apical radius. It's very simple. There are two radiuses, one of the apex, one of this, and that is what is called as eccentricity or the degree of asphericity. Same thing. Okay. So circle is a sphere. Anything after circle, ellipse, this, any other angle you cut it, it is a sphere. And therefore, it is eccentric and has two values. So, we start with circle is zero, circle is sphere. So, whether you are talking Q value, E square, eccentricity, SF, shape factor, you see, each machine has to give something different. Their engineers cannot put the same. If one company's machine says Q, other fellow says SF, that fellow says, third fellow says E square. They are just talking about the conic section. Conic section has two values, apical radius and peripheral radius. It is interpreted in 100 ways you can present the material. So we start with circle is zero. If you are talking about first eccentricity, it becomes positive in prolate ellipse, which is a normal cornea. Normal cornea, the prolate ellipse, it is between 0 and 1. And parabola, hyperbola, this is like keratoconus. It will be more in positive. Post LASIK, we are discussing LASIK. Post LASIK, you will get an oblate cornea and it will become minus. Okay? If you know this much also, you don't have to get confused. But the companies confuse you. They could have only said E square, but another company talks about Q value. What is Q? Minus E square. So again, start 0, okay, prolate ellipse, instead of 0 to 1, 0 to minus 1. Okay, 0 to minus 1, oblate, so it becomes plus, more than 0, instead of more than, less than 0. Okay, now shape factor. Shape factor is identical to E square. Correct? So it will be positive 0 and it will be less than 1. This is a mistake in typing. Okay, so now Zeiss. Zeiss is a very good machine. Okay, Actilus. But they are the only ones who talk about SF, shape factor. So when you take a printout of this, it says shape factor normal. Okay, it's within point positive. We saw shape factor is normal, positive. Okay, so they will talk about shape factor. Shape factor measures corneal asphericity, the rate of flattening or steepening of the cornea from the flattest meridian. Positive shape factor is prolate cornea and negative is a oblate cornea. Okay, so is equal to negative of Q. See, Q is negative of E square. Shape factor, so that is why it is just looking confusing. So normal cornea is prolate, curvature flattens, and this is called as positive, the E square is positive and positive asphericity. Okay. After that, post LASIK, you have a oblate cornea, means it steepens from the apex to the periphery. E square is negative and this is negative asphericity. Enough of theory and all this. Now we will come to actual patients. So this is how in JJ Hospital, where I do maximum about 2000 eyes a year, you are now working to do 2000 surgeries a year, LASIK. How many pre-ops you have to see? Some don't come back, some don't have money, some are unfit. So topos must be 5000 a year. So this is from that data. So normally that machine gives 4 pictures. So these two are what we discussed, elevation. Okay, front elevation and posterior elevation. Pachymetry, because we said elevation gives you cross section. And this is placebo. We'll discuss only the placebo. We are not concerned with the others. Okay. And pachymetry. So Rahul, 22-year-old male, came with right eye K1, K2, 47.8, 45, it is written here. Left eye 43, 41, pachy, right eye 482, 531. Remember, everything in the body is symmetrical. So even pachy should be symmetrical, K should be symmetrical. So, and he has got asymmetric bow tie. So as I said, it's impossible actually to distinguish this fellow from the 3 lakh normal asymmetric bow ties. But we have to try. Okay, companies are charging 35 lakhs for this machine. So they will try very hard. Because they simply say, no, Dr. Kapoor said it's impossible. Then who will buy the machine? Okay, and the whole game must go on. So, now, we look at that same. We are only going to see this map. Okay, this map. So, you will see it in 2 scales. Axial, this axial map is written there. Don't try to study. Everything is given. Answers are given. You don't have to study. The axial map, absolute scale and normalized. This much you must learn. Absolute scale, we said, is for screening. So you must stick to absolute. Normalize if you want details, we don't want. Now, KEM fellows sit and count all these numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Arre, ye toh axial hai. You know, we are all from JJ. How will remember how many numbers and colors? You look from far, too many colors. Ye kam color, ye absolute hai, ye normalized hai. Simple, you don't have to sit and count everything, you know. So you should know that, and you can see now normalized scale, there's more detail than this. Same thing, there's a curvature map. See, this noisy. It's written there, instantaneous. Instantaneous curvature, each company calls it different. So you can see compared to this, it's a very smoothened out picture. So this gives you more details. Again, axial map, absolute scale, normalized scale. You should learn to just pick up like that. Okay, you don't need details. Pachymetry, because it's giving you optical cross-section, thousands of points, thousands. So apex and thinnest point should be usually within 1 millimeter because the apex is thinnest. Okay, so this gives you these 2 readings. As far as we are only concerned with LASIK, we are only concerned with 1 contraindication, keratoconus. That is usually inferior, so the thinnest point will be inferior. The whole game is that we are only concerned with keratoconus. So if these two points are next to each other, it's probably normal. If they are not next to each other, it's probably keratoconus. Okay, we are not concerned for anything else. There are a lot of formulas. All formulas satta vaza. See, this is same patient, this formula says 95% similarity, like radiologists, they'll never commit. Clinical correlation required, they'll just put the arrow there, you know. This fellow also clinical interpreted similarity, nothing. This one's 55% similarity, okay. Now, this, if you take like my young friend Israni and all, you know, Neeraj, he's told me I've come from Nayana Netralaya and all that. I have a core fellowship in optics and all. I don't know what is optics, but anyway, he's done in ophthalmology also. Optics, ophthalmology, refractive. And he and all these youngsters but more intelligent than me, KEM, NASA, they know the value of all these indices. So when I talk, I little laugh and I talk upar, you know, my. So one that day Parvi got up and all, she's also from LV Prasad and all. That what is the normal value of this? I said, I don't know. Why should I know? Because there are 200 indices. And isn't it common sense? Lal color means red. Mat jao udhar. This is not finished. If it is yellow, if it is green, you can go. Why you are studying so much? We don't have to study so much. And the companies also know that there are two types of doctors. One KM wala and one JJ wala. KM wala knows the values, JJ wala doesn't know. So uske liye lal, green and yellow means machine also doesn't know. What is it? What to do with this value? So there are three types of values. And why so many indices? They are trying to prove what can't be proved. That this normal, that this asymmetric bow tie, is it 3 lakh people who have normal asymmetric bow tie? From 1,000 such pictures, 999 is normal population. Only one is suspect. How to differentiate? So the engineers are saying, SAI, surface asymmetry index. God knows whatever the value of 2 or 3 or whatever it is. This is red, so obviously 3 is more. Okay. DSI, differential sector. So they divide it into sector. Compare this sector to this. If it was uniform, it's normal. If it was keratoconus, it won't be uniform. Now that was discovered. What did the other fellow discover? The other engineer. There's so many companies. So he makes surface regularity index. Regularity, okay. Opposite sector, OSI. Opposite means this fellow said this sector and this sector. I'll take this sector and opposite sector. Let us compare it. So they are trying to prove regularity and irregularity. Very difficult. So now each machine has 120 different names. This index, this index. All the machines give 3 colors, red, green and yellow. If it is red, it's abnormal. If it is green, it's okay. And if it's yellow, nobody knows what to do with it. Okay. So this is what it is. Now this is the left eye of that patient. See the left eye, absolute scale, normalized. See normalized scale. See, this is the value of normalized scale, but you don't need it for screening. That something is there in the left eye also. Okay, this is the curvature maps, absolute scale, normalized scale. Pachymetry, apex and thinnest point same and close to each other. So no, everything green, green, green. Okay. Okay. So Amol, -8, -7 is pre-op. Post-op, you'll get this. If you see this round, you know, blue area, it means it is operative. LASIK flattening, correct? Absolute scale. Curvature map. See, curvature gives you more detail. The junctional area where the treatment ends. Okay, this is a computer. It gives you pre-op, post-op, minus pre-op to post-op. What is the difference? Tissue, what was removed? So pre-op, post-op, this was the difference. So it, you get plays with the data. Okay. Now this is, as we said, Zeiss machine. It gives you, see, post-op LASIK, the shape factor became negative. Okay. So normally in green, the normal value is here positive, and that is different. Hemlata, 25 years old. Simple myopic astigmatism, -5. Okay. No sphere, pure -5. Okay. Now 46, 42. Okay. So this is the axial maps. Absolute scale, normal. It's written here axial. I don't know how to find out. Okay, so you have to just read it there. And you can see post-op in a curvature map or instantaneous map, more details. Again, absolute scale, normalized scale, and difference, pre-op, post-op difference. If you see red, red, it doesn't mean keratoconus steep, steep, steep. It could be post-hypermetropic LASIK. Hypermetropic LASIK steepens the center. So Hemlata, 45-year-old, plus 3, she came, good pachymetry, 591. Post-op redness, it's post-hypermetropic LASIK. Axial map is written there. Instantaneous is written there. This is normalized scale, this is absolute scale. The shape factor, again, become too much positive in hypermetropic. Okay? So, this is, acha. Now, this machine is not bought by corneal surgeons. I told you, corneal surgeons don't have money to buy this because they get poor patients, corneal ulcer, this, that, they don't have money because 2 months it doesn't heal. When I did corneal fellowship, my boss, director of corneal services, M.E. Prasad Eye Institute, he told me, cornea may there are only 3 things, I forgot also, I'm from JJU, I don't remember all this. But corneal ulcers which never heal. Corneal grafts which always go pink. So pale. So, but whatever it is, but this is this machine is with LASIK surgeons, not with corneal surgeons. Okay. LASIK surgeon, the company engineer also knows. He must know if he wants to sell, he must have rapport between customer and engineer. Okay. So anything that goes wrong with the machine, it says keratoconus, yes or no. For example, this was in JJ, first 5 years, I used to do all the work myself. Topo, this, that, filling up. Because it's a very busy cataract department. And everybody is busy there, residents and all. But so once one resident came to help, automatic table, you know, nowadays when you give 35 lakh machine, they give you 5,000 ka table free with the electric. You just press it and go up and down. Yet, you know, and a resident stage, you're lazy. So he was sitting on the opposite side, patient was on the opposite side putting, and the poor short patient was trying to reach, and the damn thing was there. He can just bring the table down by pressing one foot, zoom, electrically it will come down. He didn't do. Then he said, "Are you care to corner say?" But before seeing that also, I had gone and put. So this shows 30% chance of keratoconus. You put the table straight, 0% chance of what? Whatever you ask this machine, it will tell you keratoconus yes or no, keratoconus yes or no. Okay, because they know it's a LASIK patient, 50,000 years brought. Doctors must worry keratoconus hai ki nahi. Rest all is afterwards. Okay, so that answer you will get first. Second thing, it is very sensitive to tears. Okay, why? Tears, you all have learned power of cornea is 43. Wrong. 100% wrong. Power of tears is 43. It is, power is difference of refractive index divided by radius of curvature. Refractive index, the jump is 1.3 to 1.0, 33 points. When it goes from tears to cornea is 0.04. 33 to 30. When it goes again posterior cornea to aqueous, it's 0.04. There is no power generated in the cornea. It is generated at the level of the tears. So if you have a dirty tears, if you've got a dryness, this, that, it will give you all odd readings. So you have got 43 at the tear air interface, plus 5 when it goes from tear to cornea, and minus 6 when it goes from cornea to aqueous. This cancels each other. Even if you want to keep minus 1, chalo. 43 minus 1, 42 is the power of the cornea. But you put a little tear substitutes, put a little, improve the tear. See, this is all irregular, but you see, normal 46, 44, normal low pachy, 479. Okay, curvature maps, absolute scale, normalized scale, see, 17% keratoconus. 17% keratoconus. You put artificial tears and everything clears up. Okay, and green, 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 the whole thing became green. Okay, so patient is okay. So, as I said, we are trying to do the impossible. You know, how can you defeat nature and God? God wants to do a little masti. So he has put this asymmetric bota in normal people. Okay, and 1/3 of them, and made keratoconus incidence 2 in 1 lakh, 30 in 1 lakh. So you can't, so everybody's trying 100 ways. So what is the thickness of the cornea? Keratoconus is a disease where it becomes thin. It's become an industry.
Pachymetry now, I have made 100 slides on pachymetry. Each company has got 22 formulas like those indices of curvature. And then this graph, and the graph is going slow, and a quick slope, and a fast slope, and it's just become an industry, okay? Even then, just a little bit, if you go by Western literature, half of India is keratoconus. Because they say 500 pachymetry, 499 becomes FFKC, form first keratoconus. India is a short 5 foot race. Our corneas are also thin. They are comparing to 6 foot giants who have got 580, 600 corneas. So if you go by this literature, whole India is keratoconus, okay? But this is the only literature in the imported foreign books, big books, okay, foreign publishers. So the computers give you thinnest point, okay? And then they'll say, compare difference between thickest and thinnest. They make another formula about it, indice. So if it is 130, okay. If it is less than 100, it is FFKC, okay. So then, now new things is relative pachymetry. If this is the apex, this should be thinnest. So we know that, so you change the scale. What is the percentage of thickness as you go in the periphery? So relative pachymetry map, if it is more than 9% at a particular point, you know, the whole thing is this. If you go to this pentacam, they make the graphs like this with two standard deviations. So if this red line is the patient, it should be within this thing. And then again, you know, they call it CTSP, and the same graph in percentage. What is the reason for that? You have one graph, we have understood, you know. So the same graph is available as a percentage, PTI. So this is CTSP, this is PTI, see CTSP, PTI. It's following the same. Okay, so 100 formulas, 100 indices, chasing a needle in a haystack. You can't find out. Okay, so progression index, this curve, so it will say, oh, what is this shape? We get into physics. How do we do shape? How do biology liya? Cockroach we have anything. So there are different quick slope, S shape, flat shape, inverted shape, this shape, that shape. We are only concerned, Baba, can LASIK karne ka ki nahi? You know, so many shapes, and this quick slope, fab slope, this slope, that's so much trying to chase this irregularity of the cornea, which might be FF. Don't mistake. Don't use wrong words. Don't say keratoconus. Keratoconus, apna first year resident can diagnose. Either there'll be hydrops, white scar, or there'll be corneal nerves enlarged, thinning, flesher, ring. There is no keratoconus. There's no keratoconus? Then what are we searching? FFKC. There's nothing. Then by definition you said there's nothing, then why are we searching? FFKC is defined. So now I did study, I told you we are not from KEM, but JJ Burgess, once they start digging, they get to the bottom of the matter. So what is FFKC? I started searching. So one fellow 100 years back said that the normal eyes in the families of people who are keratoconus should be called FFKC because they might get keratoconus. He himself called it normal eyes. And now we are searching and labeling the whole damn population as FFKC. You know, just because they had an asymmetric bow tie, which nature put in 33% of the country. 33 crore people in India have got an asymmetric bow tie on tomography. So where did FFKC come into the picture? You know, so this is how we should call it FFKC and not, of course, keratoconus. So the Zeiss, like we said, the technologies are slit scanning, op scan, the oldest, shine, fluke, pentacam. Zeiss combines the Placido with the OCT to give you the cross section and the anterior, posterior, and the pachymetry. They, as we saw, take shape factors, SIM, corneal irregularity measurement, mean toric keratometry, their own formulas. You know, something. So, corneal irregularity represents irregular resting merism. TKM, toric keratometry, tells the toricity of the cornea. And all these together tells you irregular cornea. So it gives you three values, SIM, TKM, and shape factor. It also uses the OCT like this, that, okay, for example, this patient, okay, this patient has obviously a very steep cornea and asymmetric bowtie, then the OCT can be used to see relative pachymetry and posterior elevation. 4 is normal, relative pachymetry, so is normal. Okay, even then see, it said 50% suspect, 30% normal. So in this case, for example, you know, or this is the next case, sorry, that this asymmetric bowtie, so it can show you pachy is 8%, which is, you know, abnormal, and 11 micron is abnormal. In this machine, anything above 9 in both the situations is abnormal. So 11 is abnormal, and relative pachymetry 8 is abnormal almost. The last slide. Baba, they have made an industry of pachymetry, but we, as I am saying, are short people. We have thin corneas. And you can see this last patient, Jagdish, 29-year-old, minus 2.5, minus 1 cylinder, pachy 391. Okay, he's normal. There's nothing wrong with him. One girl came, I'm from Nayana Nitrala, and one of these talk. You should look at all the other maps carefully. Means I'm not looking carefully. You know, so, you know, once there's a little bit of thinning, you know, there's always some defect, you know, and you know, take it. You have come from Nayana Nitrala, hum log to Mohammad Ali Road, say JJ Hospital. You know, so we don't want to compare and we don't want to argue with anybody. But you can get just thin people. They've got thin corneas. You look, all the values are normal. The ops can 52.13, anterior elevation, posterior elevation. You see the other values, 3 millimeter, 5 millimeter zone. Everything is normal. Sorry, that was the second last slide. The last patient is 20-year-old, 48, 49. In fact, shouldn't make his name, but one of the Nayana Nitrala fellows has just joined JJ. So he spent some time with me. And now, if he sees this patient, 48, 48, 49, 47, pachy 422, thin pachy, 49 is steep cornea. So what to do? So this is the axial map, okay, is absolute scale, asymmetric bow tie. This is also axial and normalized scale. You can see ideal asymmetric bow tie, pachy 427, but thinnest point is nearby and not different, okay. Everything is green. It's a normal steep cornea. Just like the previous last fellow was a normal, very short fellow, very thin, 399 pachy. This fellow is very, very steep. It has nothing to do with it. So 49, 47, 428 pachy, other eye, left eye. Yes, there is asymmetric bowtie. Again, pachy 430, but they are close to each other and not different. Okay, green, green, green. As a result of this confusion, you know, last slide is that another one fellow also made one chart, you know, Randleman's risk assessment scoring. So if it is, you know, you what, same thing, if it's a high myope, more chance of keratoconus. If it is a thinner cornea, the chance increases. If it is younger patient, the same what is written in Parson, that keratoconus is in young patient, high astigmatism, this, that, he made a damn chart out of it. Okay, and lowest chances if it is low myopia, good pachymetry, old patient, then it's not keratoconus. Same Parson's paragraph he has put into a graph. Thank you so much.
Hello. Sashi, you were supposed to come and clarify some doubts. All of us, none the wiser after your half an hour. You overshot your time by 20 minutes. I think the masala, but what is the take home message? Don't do
you
topography.
Said that we are going to tell.
That she's going to tell. But she's confused. She just told me she's so confused. What is she going to say? Half an hour.
He has reassured many of my beliefs that we are going down. I used to know about force, doing up to 460. I have told you many
times. Sanjeev will be able to tell us, Siddharth will be able to tell us. I mean, Sanjeev, 391, I haven't seen a cornea as thin as that. Have you seen? 391? I wouldn't say. Okay, but you know, so we are going to follow this system. That after the lecture, the person who has extolled your virtues is going to give a short synopsis. It's a tough task now. It's very tough. So short, you just 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Sir gave a very interesting and animated talk on the corneal topography. Even though it was a little difficult for me to understand, I'll try to summarize as best as possible. Sir spoke about the latest procedures that are in vogue to see the corneal topography. The corneal topography are basically maps which describe the corneal shape and optics. Then sir went on to describe Placido disc, which is one of the very commonly used techniques, versus Pentacam. Sir also spoke about elevation topology, which gives optical cross sections, pachymetric maps and elevation maps, which depending on the color coding system, which forms a very integral part of corneal topography, helps us to interpret the thinness and the thickness of the cornea.
Sorry, sir. He is asking you between that same Sushma's question, but did you do that patient? Did you do this?
See, this is not a
This is not a Sorry, sir.
One of the very important points I would like to mention is a machine is best studied by one person. If you know your machine very well, I think you'll be able to handle that machine very well. So since sir has done research in a particular area, he was able to give us a lot of information about it. And the main crux of the whole talk was whether there is an entity called asymmetric bota in normal patients, which might be easily confused with keratoconus. For LASIK surgery especially, it is important to differentiate whether it's a normal asymmetric bota or whether keratoconus is present or not. Thank you.